We will get started. Good evening all to this weekly huddle, session number 41. My name is Anoop Agrawal. I am an interventional cardiologist at Care Hospital, Hyderabad. I am joined by my colleague and co-host for the session, Dr. Praneeth Polamuri. This huddle is an unscripted audience level interaction where we address common clinical scenarios like that of today, where we are going to talk something very basic, that is smoking cessation. We aim to keep the discussion patient practice oriented, so I typically bring up a clinical case and we try to restrict our discussion around that particular case. Although today's case is going to be slightly more generic in discussion. The basic premise of the huddle is to bring our casual hallway discussion to a more organized platform so that we can get some meaningful discussion out of it. While we do welcome science and guidelines, with huddle we tend to help a physician translate what is established knowledge to a clinical practice, taking local factors and practice patterns into account. We host this session every Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. like that of today. And today's topic is smoking cessation. To assist in our discussion, I am pleased to announce that we have got few guests for today's discussion. We have Ms. Tharana Sethupathi. She is a psychologist, consultant psychologist at Uchwas Transitional Care Center in Hyderabad. And we have got Mr. Vijay, who is a chief physiotherapist at the same center. We also have Dr. Jyothiramai, who is a consultant psychiatrist practicing at Continental Hospital. And we will try to get their input about this particular topic as well. And please, my apologies if I pronounced any of the names incorrectly. So having said that, let me get started. We'll brief you about today's clinical case. I will ask Praneeth to get started with his thought process, and then we will ask our attendees about how they would go with this case. And then we will ask our guests to weigh in for their input. So this is a 46-year-old male. I saw him last month. He was admitted the month prior to that for non-ST elevation myocardial infarction, where a percutaneous intervention was done to his LAD using a drug-eluting stent. His stay was there in the hospital for 3 days, which was pretty much unremarkable other than the mentioned history. Rest of his parameters are okay. He's non-diabetic and his LV function is pretty good. So he came to me last month, which was his 1 month follow-up. And at that time he mentioned that, "Doc, I'm trying to quit smoking." He smokes about 1.5 packs of cigarettes daily. And he had been doing that for off and on for about 20 years now. And now, because of his recent MI and he has got family responsibilities, he's trying to take it very seriously, and he says, "Doc, now I'm gonna quit it. In the last 1 month after my discharge, I tried to quit, but seems to be a difficult task for me to quit. I have tried quitting it a few years ago, but at that time I was not successful in quitting." So that is the basic history. And rest of the clinical findings are more or less stable now. So the discussion mostly is restricted around how we can help him quit smoking. So 46 male, no other medical history. He's on routine cardiac medication. I'm not listing it for you. The question is, how can we help him quit smoking other than simply saying, "Okay, it's a good idea, just stop smoking"? Because we know that with the addiction, which is both psychological as well as physical, at times it becomes very difficult for them to quit smoking. So Praneeth, let's say this patient comes to you in your OPD, how would you go about it? I did put in a few questions in the invite. So I'm going to put up these questions and then you can take over each of them. So the questions are, what kind of behavioral mechanisms we can suggest to him? Are there any coping mechanisms for withdrawal, which inadvertently all of these patients, they end up having? What kind of nicotine replacement you would suggest to these patients? Would you consider any drug therapy? And are there any dedicated rehabilitation program that these patients can be referred to, which will increase his chance of quitting smoking. So Praneet, you can take over and then we'll go over amongst our attendees, followed by our guests. Praneet, for you.
Yeah. So good evening, everyone. So smoking cessation, yes, very important and often neglected, and equally something which I kind of fail in getting my patients quit smoking as well. The things which I look at is first thing about the patient willingness to quit, rather than the pressure coming from the doctor or from the family members that see he always smokes and no matter whatever I say he doesn't listen. I would like to see how much is that the patient wants to quit. Unless the patient has the intention or will to quit, it never is successful. The external pressures usually do not work. The second thing I look into is why do you smoke, or what is the reason, and do you think you can quit smoking? Is I try to engage into some conversation as to knowing how did it start and what is the reason for him to continue to smoke, and some things. One thing which I consistently find is the associated behavior which these patients have. The common thing which I notice, particularly in men, is about the intention or the act of defecation, where they say that only after I smoke I can pass my stools or else I end up having constipation, which I believe is an associated behavior where they have attached smoking to their act of these morning daily chores, which has been attached. So I would say that if I can relieve your constipation problem by giving some other drugs, would you be able to quit? And that is where I try to dissociate their behaviors, giving them laxatives and etc., and try to encourage them in quitting smoking. Regarding the question about what sorts of nicotine replacements do I suggest, this is something which I'm not very comfortable or confident of it. I in general ask them to take these nicotine gums which are available, which I believe are available in 2 grams, 2 milligrams and 4 milligrams things. I ask them to take those nicotine gums, and whenever you get a craving or this feeling of urge to smoke, try to take them as and when required basis, just like what you are trying to take that cigarette that you are trying to take. And regarding the last question of any dedicated rehab centers, I could only recollect one thing, that some Hope Rehab Center is something which is there, which I believe is a de-addiction center both for alcoholics and the smokers as well. For some, again, if people say that I want to quit and I need some help, I would ask them to find these one of the rehab centers. But most of the time I find there is a difficulty or the problem is with the patient himself, where the willingness to quit is lacking. But for those who are willing or trying to quit, definitely they need help and we have to help them out. This is what is my understanding.
Praneet, have you ever prescribed inpatient rehabilitation for smoking?
No.
Have you ever prescribed any drugs to assist in quitting smoking?
Never. Other than nicotine gums and nicotine patch, no specific drug have I prescribed.
Okay, all right, Praneet, thank you for that insight. And I think that that certainly gives us a starting point for our discussion. And I'm going to invite two, three more comments before I get to my guests. We have Dr. Shankar with us. Dr. Shankar has been a regular attendee of Huddle. He's a senior physician and he certainly can give us his insight of how to go about it. Dr. Shankar, I just want to give you a certain background from the cardiology standpoint and then you can give us your insight. I personally believe that cardiologists are at a very good position because we get these patients in their vulnerable state, like acute MI or heart failure or whatnot. And at that time, we find patients' willingness to quit or modify their lifestyle much better. They're far more receptive to make changes in their lifestyle because of that acute event, as compared to run-of-the-mill patient that I see in the OPD and I tell them to quit, they tend to take it less seriously. And I believe you face on the other side of it, where you see a lot of these patients who have not had an event yet, but they continue to smoke, and you have to kind of counsel them to quit smoking. So when these patients, they come to you, how do you handle and do you prescribe medication for that? We would be interested in knowing your insight. Dr. Shankar.
Good evening to all. At the same time, I congratulate Dr. Anup Agarwal and Dr. Praneet Palamuri for conducting and continuing this educative and interactive weekly huddle. See, such cases we encounter in our clinical practice because they come with tobacco-related diseases like COPD, heart attacks, cerebral strokes, peripheral vascular disease, and lung cancer, and etc. So, as a primary care physician, it is my prime duty to ask him to quit smoking, because smoking hazards, I explained to the patient, if he continues smoking, what happens, this patient has already experienced a myocardial infarction, NST, ACS, and he had PCI with the DAS also. So the risk of tobacco smoking also associated with the high bleeding risk, especially when the patient is on blood thinners like antiplatelet agents, aspirin and clopidogrel or ticagrelor. There are chances of risk of bleeding also if the patient continues smoking. So these hazards I explained to him, and he may have another episode of myocardial infarction also if he continues smoking. So I tell the patient the hazards of smoking. At the same time, I give him a timeline. What happens when he quits smoking? There is a timeline frame is there, 20 minutes, his heart rate and blood pressure drops. After 24 hours of stopping cigarettes, chances of a heart attack decreases. 2 weeks to 3 months, his circulation improves and his lung function also increases. 3 months to 9 months, likewise, coughing. I explained all these things. Once he stops smoking, what will be the beneficial effects he will get? So after 5 years, the risk of cancer of the mouth, throat, and esophagus and all will decrease. 10 years, the lung cancer risk, it is half to that of a smoker. And 15 years, the risk of heart disease is also that of a non-smoker. So all these things I will put before him, and I'll motivate him that here, the lucky thing is the patient is already probably motivated and he is ready to follow the smoking cessation plan. The actions and the strategies for the primary care physician, when the patient is ready for the quit smoking, 5 A's one primary care physician has to follow. These they will be elaborated more with an elite psychiatrist and psychologist. Step one is ask and advise, and attempt, and assess, and assist, step four, and step five is arrange. So systematically, we identify the tobacco users. We strongly urge the smokers to quit, and we assess, we assist also with the supplementary materials and the pharmacotherapy and all these things. So arrange also, we arrange, schedule, follow up, contact either through either personally or via phone. So these ask, advise, attempt, assist, and arrange. These 5 A's one has to follow when a patient is ready for cessation of smoking. Then I personally advise him to stop abruptly telling all these hazards of smoking. And most of my patients also, especially I come across most of my patients are COPD or lung cancers and coronary artery disease, several strokes. When I told these hazards are the timeline frame of beneficial effects, most of the patients agreed to stop abruptly. And when the patient stops abruptly, better the chances of cessation of smoking will be better. I come across instead of going through the pharmacotherapy. This abrupt stoppage is known as cold turkey effect or cold turkey method. What we say, this will be elaborated by our elite psychologists and psychiatrists. Then regarding if the patient is, see, I tell 8 or 10 tips to follow how to quit smoking. I ask them to set a date, mark their calendar and plan ahead. I create accountability by telling family, friends and co-workers. Prepare the environment. So get rid of all paraphernalia and give himself time to rest by taking a sick days and find a creative ways to occupy his hands and mouth. I learn that to what the triggers are, and as far as possible, there are those two schools of thought. One is avoiding the triggers, and another school of thought is don't avoid the triggers, and track your health and money you save in an app, and reward yourself and celebrate even small achievements. Reward should be there. So these 8 or 10 tips I tell the patient to follow. Suppose I ask him to set a date that 10 days or 12 days, by this I will definitely stop, and you should inform all his friends, co-workers and housemates and all. So this method I found quite useful. If it is not useful, or the patient smokes more than 25 cigarettes a day, he is quite dependent, he is quite addictive, so that he will get some withdrawal symptoms, then I go for NRT, that is a nicotine replacement therapy. Dr. Praneeth, he nicely narrated that nicotine gums are there available in the market as a Nicotex, Cipla company. These chewable gums, they are quite helpful. And apart from this pharmacotherapy, earlier I used to give bupropion. It is available in the market as a Zybon. For the 3 months, I give this NRT as well as this Zybon. I found little useful, but recently, but for the past 2-3 years, I found very good results with Verniclin. This is available in the market as Champix or Chantix. This I found very useful. This will be very much enlightened by our colleague psychologist and psychiatrist. I got a very little experience with them, but I found very good results with this earlier with the Zybon and NRT. But now I switched over to Verniclin. I found very good results. Only thing is side effects are there. Little mood and behavioral changes are there. The suicidal tendencies will be there. And they are contraindicated in the seizure individuals. And in spite of this pharmacotherapy, NRT, and this motivational behavioral therapy, if the patient does not quit smoking, then I will leave it to my learned colleagues for the rehab. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I think that a lot of aspects you covered, going from behavioral to pharmacotherapy, and I certainly agree on a lot of things that you said, and I think each of them needs significant elaboration in terms of behavioral therapy and whatnot. A lot of it is time consuming, I must say, particularly in the clinic of a busy physician or a busy cardiologist, how we are going to manage. And I think this is where the tips and tricks come into play, and maybe a referral to somebody who can spend time with the patient, look into all the aspects that you mentioned and delve into a little bit more detail. I think that will be the crux of how we go about with this. So having said that, let me actually invite some opinion from the experts and see what their thought process would be. So if I could have Dr. Sethupathi. Dr. Sethupathi is a counseling psychologist. And ma'am, I can have you give your thought process in terms of what is going on with these patients with their smoking. And while I consider peri-MI period as an easy thing for me to discuss smoking cessation for them, but otherwise also, how do you take this into account, and what kind of tips and tricks you can suggest to physicians or cardiologists to increase their success rate amongst their patients? Dr. Sethupathi, if you could unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Anup sir and Dr. Prateep sir, for having me today, and a very good session, sir. Initially, I think for the smoking or nicotine users, we do an assessment basically in the three levels, like, you know, what kind of addiction level they are in, and the willingness, and also the trigger points, like what are the trigger points that is influencing them for the usage. It can be psychological, it can be social. So all these points we assess. And as you said, sir, like, what are they psychologically going through? Once a person decides to quit smoking, or when he is in the process, he might have a dysphoric or a depressed mood symptoms. His mood levels will be mostly lowered, and will be irritability, because he's not, you know, taking, he's not giving up the craving, or he's not feeding the craving. There will be a lot of irritability, there will be a lot of restlessness, and he might be anxious, and also he will have difficulty in concentrating, paying attention, and mostly sleep problems will also be there. So for that person is basically restless, irritated, and he's not able to follow his daily routine as well, because his the nicotine usage is part of his daily routine. So that is a major changes. So that affects his daily routine as well. So there can be the behavior modifications, like physical exercises and avoiding triggers. Trigger, as in, it can be a particular shop where he goes at a particular time to have the smoking. So if he is avoiding that shop and avoiding at that point of time, then at least 20% of the addiction can reduce, because it's particularly depending upon the biological clock, which says, okay, it's 6 o'clock. I have to go there, you know, in that shop, and I have to have a smoke. So that is major identification, and working on that would give good results. And then also finding distractions, like utilizing that time where he goes out with his friends, or where he does this nicotine usage. If he's distracting it to something that will not let him think about this, a very strong distraction, that would be very much helpful. And then it's basically like a pleasure principle, or like a pleasure behavior, because smoking gives them a pleasure, and so they do that. So instead of you know, increasing that, they can take an alternative, eating healthy habits, like not going for a junk, but something that is healthy, but will also give him the same level of satisfaction to his mouth, which is also psychologically inducing his behavior. So these behavior modifications can be, you know, utilized. And in case of coping mechanisms, they can be encouraged to change their routine, because of their routine also, like after breakfast, I'm going to have, or most of them have this habit, more than 50% of them have this habit of having the first smoke after the brushing to go for the defecation, or, you know, for the thing. So changing that routine and being physically active. And then also you can encourage them to reward their self if they are, you know, delaying their gratification. For example, if they want to smoke, right now I am feeling to smoke, it's like it's a thought. And that thought encourages the craving, and that craving gives a sensation. So this is the cycle that keeps on repeating. So we are focusing on the that thought of like, you know, okay, now I have to go and have a smoke. When that thought comes, ask them to delay that gratification. Initially, they can start by having like 15 to 20 minutes. So now I feel like smoking. Okay, fine. What is the time? Let me delay it for another 20 or 30 minutes. And then let me think about it. So slowly by slowly, ask them to delay their gratification, increase their timings. So that this is a very effective behavior management technique. And then rewarding themselves as well. When they are successful at the end of 5 days, ask them to do something or ask them themselves or take them for a movie or something like that. So these things might sound like, you know, how is it practically possible? But rewarding themselves and delaying the gratification is an evidence-based technique for nicotine usage. And psychologically, there are different psychotherapies which are aligned with the pharmacotherapy, like nicotine replacement therapy, as the doctor spoke. Like we do like cognitive behavior therapy, where we identify a particular trigger, because most of the time it can be because of stress or it can be because of marital problems, a lot of it. So identifying that and altering that would give a major impact in them, and also motivational interviewing and the mindfulness, as I said, the thought, the craving and sensation. So making them to realize this process, making them to realize this cycle and cutting it off would give them a major outbreak. And also support groups, as in they don't have to form like EAA, but there are situations where they may fail to tackle it, or they may fail and give up. So if some other person's experience is helping them, it would be fine. So these things are of greater help. And also in case of rehabilitation, I think two things that we consider. One is the level of addiction, and the next is even if the person is not smoking that much, but if he's taking like, you know, one smoke or twice a day and thrice a day, but he says that he cannot quit it by himself, because each individual have a different level and different intensity of coping mechanism. So if he is not able to, then a full-fledged rehabilitation might help him, and outsourcing help is not bad, and that would help him to quit smoke. Yes, thank you, Dr. Anu, for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am. That was quite insightful, and I was already thinking as you were speaking that I should go back to this recording later on and pretty much just write or type whatever you have said in a tabular form, which certainly is going to help both the doctors as well as the patient to go through it. May I invite Dr. Vijay Bhatina? Dr. Vijay, you may be getting a lot of these cardiac rehabilitation patients, and I'm sure a few of them continue to smoke. Is it something that comes during your discussion? And if it does, what kind of role do you play in cardiac rehabilitation about smoking particularly? Yeah. Dr. Vijay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for inviting me for the session. Basically, when we come across these kind of patients, most of them are OPD patients who comes after post angioplasties or post bypass surgeries, referring to us with some sort of pulmonary complications, particularly when there's deconditioning issues, like they cannot practice exercise because of their pulmonary complications, pulmonary issues, their dyspnea and all that, early onset of dyspnea kind of. If they walk for a little distance also, they get kind of dyspnea. So when we look back to the history, most of them have smoking habits. And then as rightly said, most by all the speakers, it is not just that easy to make them understand and then make them withdraw from the practice. It is a team effort. It is from the cardiologist to the psychologist and then physiotherapist. The role that we play as an exercise physiologist or physiotherapist is like being physically active is fundamentally so important when it comes to adhere to something like smoking cessation program. So in this context, like exercise is one of the additional treatment. I say it is not mainstay, but it's one of very important additional treatment for smoking cessation and then relieving nicotine withdrawals and all. And then particularly acute bouts of exercise practice, there is evidence coming in from most of the journals saying that practice of acute bouts of exercise, that is small bouts of exercise when there is craving, small bouts of exercise when there is relapse of that drive, is definitely. So we try to convince a patient to adhere to this program of exercise. We create a regimen where it gives bouts of exercise practices throughout the day, whenever there is a drive, whenever there is a relapse, or whenever there is a craving for nicotine, we ask the patient to do some kind of exercises which are aerobic based exercises, which will have effect on releasing something called beta endorphins, which will create a drive to the patient to create alternative thinking pattern, alternative scenario pattern. We have tried few of the patients, particularly who are having a very, very high intensity of smoking, say about 3 to 4 packets per day. So we have tried for few patients in our rehabilitation center. We cannot say that we are quite successful, but definitely the number of packs have come down. And then they are in that program now. Soon we hope for the best, and then the counseling continues. As I said, it's a teamwork. Psychologist, cardiologist, and then physiotherapist or exercise physiologist plays a significant role in creating an understanding and creating a better motivation, not only just withdrawing nicotine or craving for nicotine, but also helping them to induce a sense of confidence and creating an adherence to this program. And also by exercising and being physically active, they are going to combat pulmonary complications. They are already, most of them have got entered into, particularly their tidal volumes, their vital capacities must be significantly reduced. So we show them, we create a scenario where we make them undergo few tests, something called 6 minutes walk test, huddle test. These are the tests where they actually create sense of breathlessness and dyspnea to them, and then subjectively they'll understand their own capacity of exercise or activity. Based on that, we create a regimen, and we'll reassess them quite frequently. Based on that, we'll understand, on subject also will understand how this exercise is going to affect in their overall health and well-being. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And there are a few follow-up questions which, if we have time towards the end, we will discuss those. May I invite Dr. Jyoti Ramai for her comments? And there are a few things that I want to ask while we get the basic narrative going. Number one is, a lot of the things that we discussed up till now are mostly behavioral modification. And we know that smoking has got both the components of both psychological addiction as well as physical addiction, where you have actual physical withdrawal when people who quit smoking. So while we manage their behavioral aspect of it, their psychological, their way to help with the coping mechanism, pleasure, food, distraction, exercise, whatnot, we do have to handle their physical withdrawal at some point, because they do get very irritated. They start having tremors. They get jittery and whatnot. And secondly, a lot of these patients do have underlying depression, which is undiagnosed, which I'm sure you can highlight more about it. And then one particular question that I have for you is, while we talk about smoking cessation, your thoughts on upfront drug use in these cases, rather than waiting for a relapse to occur, where patient does try to quit himself or herself, and when they fail, then we go for a drug as a second therapy versus an upfront drug therapy. So if you could give your insight on the smoking cessation as a general, and maybe address a few of the questions that I have in my mind. Dr. Jyoti Ramai, please go ahead.
Good evening, Anup sir and Praneet sir. Thank you for including me. I'll just share some experiences regarding smoke cessation.
Ma'am, your voice is a little bit faint. Is it possible for you to get closer to the mic?
Yeah, am I audible now?
You are slightly better, yes.
Yeah. So the first thing I want to throw light is that most of the patients who come to us for either cardiac problems or any other problems, the main reason for most of them not to divulge their history of smoking is sometimes they feel that the clinicians might be judgmental. So the first and foremost thing is that we'll have to start with being non-judgmental and trying to ask them open-ended questions. See, rather than asking them, like if we get a history of smoking from an individual, do you want to quit smoking? Or like questions like, do you think, you know that smoking is quite unhealthy for you and your child, so why are you smoking? So instead of asking closed-ended questions, so maybe we can ask them about what is their opinion? What do you think about quitting smoking? So what is your opinion about quitting smoking? So that let them in their own words try to express their opinion about quitting smoking, and also let us also ask them, what do you think, what do you know about the adverse health effects of smoking? So that we at least will try to know how much knowledge they have about the health adversities of smoking, and then we can grade the patients into categories like, are they prepared to quit smoking or they are still under pre-contemplation or contemplation phase. If individuals are in pre-contemplation or contemplation phase, that is, they have not yet made up their mind to quit smoking, then we guide them to motivational interviewing to the psychologist for further therapy sessions. But here in the case scenario that we are discussing, this patient himself has come and he has asked that I want to quit smoking. And the best time to quit smoking is this post-MI. We have seen studies say that within 6 months to 1 year, if we initiate smoking cessation, many of them get over the habit of smoking. So here for this individual, he's under preparedness phase. He has prepared his mind that he wants to quit smoking. So we have to get him into action phase. By broadly, we can categorize the smoking cessation because there will be withdrawal symptoms. If he's taking 1.5 pack of cigarettes, that is about more than 10 cigarettes per day, definitely if he suddenly stops, there can be physical symptoms like anxiety symptoms, sweating, sleeplessness, getting irritation, restlessness and all. So to prevent all that, because of this, we will have to put him on some medications or some replacement. So broadly, we categorize this smoking cessation like for nicotine replacement therapy is one thing we tell, bupropion is one thing, and like sir has mentioned, varenicline, that is Champix tablets. So under these, most commonly used are nicotine replacement therapy because the chewable gums and the patches are readily available. My experience with many people who are admitted, we usually give them these 24-hour patches, which come under 7 mg, 14 mg and 21 mg doses. And people who are ready to, we first offer them this chewable gums because they are easily available and it is easily taken. And initially, he's smoking like less than 20 cigarettes per day. So we offer him a 2 mg chewable gum and we tell him not to take more than 15 chewable gums per day. And we also have to tell him about the side effects associated, because most of the time for them to be not compliant with the treatment is the side effects, irritation in the mouth and all. So a knowledge about the side effect profile beforehand can help in it. And if he's not tolerating the chewable gums, then we can offer him the next mode of smoking cessation treatment, that is the Champix or the varenicline tablets. And usually in our routine clinical practice, what we do is this nicotine replacement therapy also, we only give for a 2-week period. We ask them to come after the 2-week period. And bupropion, I personally have not used much in smoking, especially for cardiac and hypertensive patients, because we have to monitor their BP regularly. And it is definitely contraindicated in seizure patients. But people who are having depression symptoms and maybe people whose BP is under control, we can also add a 150 mg bupropion to them, because it helps in
reducing the pleasurable effects of smoking. Then we'll have to tell them that, okay, what most of people do is that they also smoke, like if they are smoking 10 cigarettes, let us say, they start the nicotine replacement chewing gums, but they also keep smoking in between. So in between they take these gums and also they take the cigarettes. So we will have to tell them to keep a quit date and mental preparedness, so that after 1 week or 2 weeks, see what is the date that you want to quit smoke. Until that time, maybe we can give him a bupropion tablet to reduce craving, and then we can start with NRT, because many people abuse this NRT also. They keep taking the chewable gums. And recently what the newer, this Champix varenicline, we have seen good results, you know, good results wherein, but the duration of treatment is little bit of a longer duration. Definitely daily usage is required for 3 months period. The first day we give them a 0.5 mg once a day. Then second to seventh day we give them 0.5 mg twice a day, and then we increase it to 1 mg twice a day. The major side effects are nausea and changes and all. We need to monitor. The same thing, like side effect profile, if we tell them before that if you are having any mood changes, please let us know so that we can reduce the dosage or stop the drug. And if at all the patient has completely stopped smoking after a 12-week period, after a 3-month period, then we continue the maintenance for another 12 weeks to prevent relapses. So this is the general medications that we use for to reduce the withdrawal symptoms of smoking. Yeah, so I think if any question.
Ma'am, one question that I have is, in your practice or in your suggestion, do you think we should go for an upfront drug therapy, or you think we should give them a try first with nicotine replacement, and if they fail, then we go for drug therapy?
See, always it's better that we go for nicotine replacement first, because there are a lot of studies put in replacement. So after, if nicotine replacement is not working, then usually I go for the varenicline or the Champix tablets.
Perfect. Thank you so much, ma'am. I invite any comments or questions from the attendees. You can either raise your hand, or you can type a question in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and speak for any comments or questions. I'll take 2-3 minutes to justify. I always, in every discussion, I tend to justify why I'm talking about this particular topic, other than the obvious fact that smoking cessation is important. And all the physicians, we should have at least some tips and tricks in under our sleeve. So I'll share with you a very quick anecdote. If any one of you enter in my OPD, me and Dr. Praneet, we share the same OPD room. If you enter in our OPD, you will see a big packet of cigarette sitting in the display where we have our books and other displays. And it is right up there, and it is glaringly obvious to any person who walks into the room. And inadvertently, we have this discussion started amongst our patients every now and then, where somebody asks us that, doctor, why is a big pack of cigarette sitting in your display? And the story goes is one of Dr. Praneet's patient, whom we counseled them to quit smoking after an MI, he came the next time during the follow-up, brought this packet with him and said to Dr. Praneet that this is what he has at home. And he, in a sense, is quitting and giving it to Dr. Praneet to say that that is all, and now I'm not going to smoke anymore. That box still sits in our display, and every patient whom we are successful in making them quit that smoking, that patient comes and signs on that box. So that box has got at least few signatures now so far, with all the successful quit. The idea here is that we all kind of define our own ways in which we can engage in discussion and kind of try to convince the patient how to quit, what to do, what are the good things. The whole idea is, once a conversation starts, then at least we can take it somewhere. In this particular patient, it's the patient who is starting the conversation, so life becomes a little bit easy. During my training in US, we had a very, I would say, systematic way of managing these drug therapy. And one of my intention of having this discussion was making my attendees familiarize with the drug therapy that we use. So the way I was taught was that we have got three patches of 7, 14, and 21 milligrams. And based upon how frequent is your patient smoking, whether he's smoking one pack versus two pack versus three pack, you can choose that particular dosing patch, and that person can put that patch for 24 hours. Similarly, for the nicotine gum, if they are a heavy smoker, then you give them a 4 milligram nicotine gum, versus if they are not that heavy smoker, you can give them 2 milligram gum and tell them that pretty much one gum will equal to one smoke. And the third aspect was, and this is again, I want to highlight very much, is the dosing regimen of Champix that we are using. The original brand name is Chantix, and in India it is marketed as Champix, which is Varnicelin brand name. And it comes in a starter pack where it has got 11 tablets of 0.5 milligrams and then subsequent tablets of 1 milligram. And the reason why it has got 11 tablets is because you give 0.5 milligrams daily for 3 days, and then 0.5 twice a day for the next 4 days. So that makes it 11 tablets. From day 8, they take 1 milligram twice a day, and you pretty much start them on day 0 and tell them that you put a quit date somewhere around day 8 or day 9. So by that time, you get some drug in your system so that you have less withdrawal symptoms or less depressive symptoms. And then the side effects and everything, all the profile that we have spoken about. So that was my agenda of why I wanted to bring this topic for the discussion. One, to try and understand what kind of tips and tricks we can play around. And second, to get familiarized with the drug therapy, which is available to us and which is pretty much, which is very easy. Now, I must say, because most of the audience here is cardiologist, that these drugs, they are not really, none of these drugs are studied in peri-MI period. So we don't know whether they are going to cause any problem in a patient who is recovering from acute MI. So for our patients who come to us in the first or second visit, it makes sense for us to use non-pharmacologic measure or at the most nicotine replacement. And it gives them 1 or 2 months to relax. And at the same time, it buys us time as well for the acute MI to recover. And then we can safely put them on these drugs. Now, I don't know whether these drugs will actually do harm or not, but it's just that it's not studied in the peri-MI period. So it may not make sense. It may not make too much sense to start during that time. That was my whole idea. I do want to ask a question to any person, any attendee who is in the huddle today. And then I will go to Dr. Somaraju for his comments on this. So, I think it was Dr. Sethupathi who brought up this topic of pleasure food. And I think this is very important, where patients who crave for smoking, and we can do this behavioral modification where we tell them you use the pleasure food and this and that and whatnot. I guess patients who are recovering from acute MI, we are already giving them a lot of restriction. You cannot eat this, you cannot eat that, you reduce your salt intake, you reduce your fat intake, no fried items, blah, 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 and all those kind of things. Essentially, we are making their life bland by telling them, don't do this, don't do that, and whatnot. And if a person is a chronic smoker, and now if we introduce quit smoking into that as well, from the behavioral standpoint, I can only imagine how much taxing that will be for that person, where he or she can't have salt, can't have fried food, can't have mutton, can't have sugar, can't have whatnot, and now can't even have smoking. So maybe at some point we have to be mindful of this, that we necessarily should not introduce too many restrictions at that particular standpoint, and maybe slowly bring one after another. That is one thing, and if time permits, I'm going to get back to Dr. Sethupathi in terms of how to get about it. But before I do so, if I can invite Dr. Somaraju. Dr. Somaraju does not need any introduction. He's the senior most cardiologist that we have. And sir, if you could just give us some insight upon what we have been discussing so far and how do you take it for your patients. Dr. Somaraju, please.
Thank you, Anup. If you and Praneet, if you recall, we had in our outpatient, the nurses following up our patients on telephone, and also we had a clinical psychologist in our outpatient. And this we had a clinical psychologist as a part of our team. Not today, it was last more than almost 10 years. And the you remember Dr. Pujita, she was trained as a clinical psychologist at James William James College of Psychology at Boston. William James was the father of psychology, actually. The psychologist would know here. But while I say this, and it has to be done as a teamwork, and that's the reason why I just brought out this issue. And once they're exposed to the physician, the nurses and the psychologists, they follow it up. The clinical psychologist should be part and parcel of every major department of medicine or surgery or whatever it is. Cardiology, every cardiology department worth its salt should have a clinical psychologist as part of the team. But clinical psychologists want to practice independently. That is not real contribution. I'll leave it at that, except telling you, psychology is the soul of medicine today. And psychologists should be part and parcel of everything we do. Having said that, I just want to also point out, when you say 40 plus years person, first thing we'll want to know is, what is he? What does he do as a person? That person-centeredness is fundamental. What is his job? What is his work? What is his education? What is his income? What, there is a concept called causes of causes. Why is he smoking? Why is somebody doesn't exercise? Why somebody does something else? And we want to know more about this person before we start advising them, etc. And I have more things to say. There is a concept brought out by Morgan Engels at University of Rochester in 1970s. Psychologists should know it, and psychiatrists should know it. And he brought out this idea of biopsychosocial and spiritual. Spiritual is not religion. It is a belief system. And having said this, a follow-up of these patients by one of the members of the team, be it a nurse or psychologist or anyone, should be done frequently. Initially more frequently, later less frequently. About the drugs, I won't talk about it. Most of you already talked about it. Then when you have to see them, the physician or a cardiologist should spend at least one visit of their time enough to emphasize the importance of this stopping to smoke. And after that, they can do it once in a way, not necessarily all the visits. And their follow-up should be more frequent than what we do with the rest of the patients. And their follow-up should be affordable to them. Somebody is rich, charge them. But if somebody is less rich, make it affordable to them. The whatever it requires. And one thing also I wanted to point out, Dr. Anoop, you talked about patients who had a heart attack or etc. and smoking. Patients who had a heart attack, patients who had a bypass surgery, most of them stop smoking themselves. It is the other groups that we have to deal with. And chronic stable anginas, and patients who had no intervention of any kind, even after angioplasty, they continue to smoke after some time. And if there are any questions, I will answer. But most importantly, psychology should be part and parcel of medicine we practice. And unfortunately, the medicine we practice and systems we practice don't realize it. Psychologists themselves don't realize the importance of themselves. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I think the two very important takeaway points from you, one is the role of clinical psychologist, and it certainly takes me back to my training days where pretty much every single service where I was a part of, we had a so-called clinical pharmacist and a clinical psychologist, a part of rounding team. I can't recollect any rotation where I was where I did not have a clinical pharmacist who would cross-check our medications and make sure we are doing it the right way, and a clinical psychologist who would always go back to the patient after our rounds to discuss the behavioral aspect. So I certainly have seen it, and I can appreciate the utility that they add to our modern clinical medicine. Other than just reciting what you said in terms of the problems associated, I think you are better placed to tell us how to resolve this, because in our so-called systems in place, we really don't value these soft additions in our clinical practice, partly also because they are not directly businessy, if there is a term for that. So Dr. Somaraju, if I have to talk to my hospital and say that, you know, these are things which add value and we should start it, how do we go about that?
Actually, you remember you and Praneeth should remember we had one Dr. Pujita, who was working in our outpatient as a clinical psychologist. And earlier, another girl worked with us. She is in Canada now. And we, as you said, I always had that as part and parcel of my team, and right from the beginnings. And then I agree, the hospital administrators and the present systems of healthcare system, the based upon, say, investor-based systems, are not compliant for these things. But it's up to us as professionals and who practice medicine to insist upon it and say that this should be done.
Thank you so much, sir. And the other thing which Dr. Somaraju always mentions, which I take it very passionately and I would share with my attendees, is this concept of causes of causes. I think this initially sounds a little bit oxymoron, but if you think about it, it is probably one of the most fundamental things that we do, which is to identify why somebody is behaving in a certain way. There is actually an entire field of study called behavioral psychology or microeconomics. These are two different terms for the same thing, which essentially means to understand human behavior and understand why humans are making a particular decision. So I think that is equally important for us, because if we are able to address those, and I think a few of our guests, they did mention about those trigger points, that if we are able to address those, then we'll certainly have a better success in how we practice or what we do. We are at 8:31. I would invite if anybody has got any thoughts, any suggestions or any comments or any questions about this particular topic that we are talking.
Let's tell you almost a joke. There are some patients who say that they can't stop smoking. I'm sure all of you must have faced some patients like this. I'll tell you an example of what I tell some of these patients who say they can't stop smoking. They have coronary artery disease and they are on the edge of having another ACS of any kind and sudden death. I do tell them, okay, continue to smoke, sir. What to do is I suggest that you have a cath lab installed in your bedroom so that daily you can have angiogram.
It is funny to say, sir, I speak the other way around. I heard my surgeon at Ames, who used to say this, and I repeat him whatever, I quote him whatever he used to say. So I tell my patient is, you continue to do this, just relocate and find a house nearby the hospital so that you can keep coming to the hospital. So essentially, it's the same thing. This I learned from my consultant during my MBBS days. Okay, any other questions, comments, anything from my guests, if you want to add or comment on anything, any questions for my guests or any questions for Dr. Somaraju? Maybe next 20, 30 seconds, I can take a pause.
Anup.
Yes, Praneeth.
So now that we know that everyone is important equally in helping the patient, you know, how make it effective? Like we have... And how interact or when to call them, when should we call? Like you brought up the issue of in-hospital psychiatry visit and all. Can we kind of have a rough sketch at least where we can work upon from today itself, where this program can be more effective?
So I think the best person to answer that will be Dr. Vijay. I think we had you last time in our cardiac rehabilitation discussion, Dr. Vijay, because you are going to be the key point whenever patient, particularly who is recovering from an acute insult, is coming for a cardiac rehabilitation. How do we get behavioral psychology or psychiatrist care included among the patient's overall, overview? How do we do that?
I think involving them very much in primary care. I think as soon as once we come to know he's a person who smokes, and then he's a person who cannot withdraw himself, he needs some help, then that is the point where you can sort of refer to us, where we'll make a regimen for them, both psychologically, as sir said, medicine is all about psychosocial model. We adopt that and then we include his regimen, quantifying that. And then whenever he comes for an OPD next, we can keep updating to you about his regimen and his adherence of the protocol. So as early as possible, as soon as possible, it can be directed. I think the results are more good, the outcomes are more better.
So I think one of the biggest hurdle is, and anybody can chime into this, one of the biggest hurdle is asking the patient or expecting the patient to keep making repeated visits for different kind of scenarios. I fundamentally believe if we can club the services together, where in the same, under the same umbrella, you have got cardiologist in one wing, you have got psychologist sitting in, ideally in the room next, but if not, at least in the same wing, and you have got a cardiac rehabilitation expert, maybe on the same floor or a floor up or down, where people communicate to each other, a patient comes for a cardiologist visit, and that same visit can be tapped for multiple other exposures. And that way the patient also finds value in coming and visiting the hospital, where now the patient also thinks he's not just coming to see his cardiologist. The patient believes that he's coming so that the hospital is going to add value to his care, both in terms of hardcore clinical medicine, but at the same time rehabilitation, at the same time behavioral psychology, dietetics and whatnot. So in my opinion, Praneet, to answer your question, there are two ways to handle it. One is you have a comprehensive inpatient evaluation where when the patient is while admitted, just like a physiotherapist who comes to visit, rather than a physiotherapist visit, there can be a comprehensive visit where you have a room filled with physiotherapist, psychologist, and dietitian and whatnot as needed, psychiatrist as needed, where a patient gets a comprehensive care inpatient, and the same thing is replicated when they come for an outpatient visit. Now, I'm talking about an idealistic world. I don't know how to practically implement it. I believe at a group, at a team level, like what Somaraju sir had when he was there at CARE, at an individual group level, it may be possible to implement, particularly if you have a certain bandwidth to work with. But at a hospital level, how is that possible? The practicality, the logistics of it, the economics of it, I don't know. But to answer your question, that would be the ideal way I can think of where patients can get a comprehensive care. I don't know if that kind of answers what you wanted to ask, Praneet.
Yeah, makes sense. It's probably we need to break those hesitancies and probably I should say egos as well, and we should work together for the better provision of services, I should say.
Yeah, like for example, let's say in CARE Banjara, where two of us are there taking care of the patients and we have our own kind of mini setup. Of course, it is not big enough to be called a cardiology group, but certainly a small setup. And if let us say we ourselves say that we value the opinion of cardiac rehabilitation and dietitian and clinical psychologist, and if we gather enough bandwidth that we include each of those specialists in our team, now we can have that team talk to the patients while they are inpatient, at the same time follow them when they come for our OPD. I think at an individual level it's still possible, but whether that can be extrapolated to all the services, that I think we need a system change for that. Anybody else has got any questions or comments before I start asking closing comments from our guests and then Dr. Praneeth? If not, may I ask Dr. Jyotiramai, let me start with Dr. Jyotiramai. Ma'am, I think we are having you first time in the huddle. Please correct me if this is wrong. If you could give us a feedback about the model of the discussion, not the topic, but the model of discussion and how we can improve it.
Hi, sir. Yeah, this is the first time. It's quite actually, said about the group having psychologists and all. That's a very and I think some actually following, but personally the experience takes, like when someone refers, like if they are not having psychiatric disorders as such, there is a bit of a stigma coming and seeing psychiatrist. His personal experience was, otherwise it's a very the session was quite enlightening.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think that this is also important for us to understand the social stigma associated with a psychiatrist visit, and this is again something that we have to emphasize multiple times, that you know, I proudly tell my patients that I have taken psychiatric help before, to kind of break that ice, but I certainly concur what you are coming at. Dr. Shankar, you are unmuted. You have something to add?
A yoga and a meditation expert also should be included in the team, sir. Most of the hospitals have recruited yoga and meditation experts for the relaxation techniques, and so I emphasize the importance of yoga and meditation in this aspect.
Absolutely, sir. Point well taken. This is very important, and we should certainly be looking into that as well. May I invite Dr. Sethupathi for her comments about the session, the model, not the topic, but how we are conducting and how we can make it better. Dr. Sethupathi, if you could unmute yourself, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you for this opportunity, and I think it's a very good model and have no comments on that. And as sir said, very insightful from a different point of view. This forum itself is where a different physician is there, I'm there, a physiotherapist sir is there. So I think this is a very good model, as a insights from different field experts are coming in. So that is great. And as Dr. Somraj sir said, you know, biopsychosocial, I think that is happening right here in this session. So I'm very glad about it.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Dr. Vijay, your comments for the session, please.
Very insightful, sir. I think we also learned, and then this discussion forum has given a lot of information to us, and the method you think, and a lot of insightful discussion has happened from most of the speakers. Thank you so much for inviting us here.
To the attendees, particularly those who attend us routinely, we are actively considering if we should prepone the session and start it at 7 o'clock rather than 7:30. So if you have any thoughts about it, whether we should stick to 7:30 or start at 7 o'clock, please do write to me. I'm strongly considering that from April onwards, we do it at 7 o'clock. Dr. Praneeth, Dr. Somaraju, you are unmuted. You have something to add.
It's a wonderful idea. Start at 7.
Yes, sir. I'm considering this because you were the first person to suggest us that. So I'm actively looking into that. And from April, maybe we are just going to make it at 7 o'clock itself. Dr. Praneeth, your closing comments for the session.
Yeah, as always, we had a good discussion, getting or hearing into the thought process of various people in their respective fields is always insightful. Highlighting about the behavioral modification, trying the help of psychologist who can give their insight or help them in modifying the behavior, helping them quitting, helping them to achieve the quitting, and equally the help of psychiatrist in therapy. And I think with the ease of availability, most of the physicians and cardiologists should also be probably comfortable prescribing Nicotex and the varenicline in their prescription, know how to prescribe, and equally prescribe them more deliberately so that we can help them quit smoking. So definitely insightful, and few things, many of things which I learned, and definitely would implement prescribing these things for me, for my patients. This is what I have, Anup.
Thank you, Praneet, and thank you all for attending today's session. Special thanks to my guests for joining today. To the attendees, particularly those joining us for the first time, we would like to get your feedback, so you can email it to me. If you found the session worthwhile, may we request you to share it amongst your colleagues so that more people can join and more thoughts can be shared. We host this session every Wednesday at 7:30. The link to join the session is the same that you clicked today, so the link don't change. So in the future, for any Wednesday, if you want to join for the same time, you can just click the same link and you should be live on that day's session. All of our sessions are recorded, and at some point they do show up on podcast and YouTube. You can simply go to individual sites and search for the weekly huddle, and you will get our past recording in case if you want to listen to it. I thank you again for your time, for participating in the session. Good night, and see you again next week. Thank you all.